Good evening, everybody. So we are about to begin our 15th session of the Head and Neck Weekly webinars. As you all know that, you know, we've been having a lot of talks by industry specialists up till now. I think today is our 15th session and we finished the first module on neck and we are moving on to the next module, which is the oral module. And last week we had a very good participation. You know, Dr. Abhishek Vaidya gave us a talk, enlightening talk on the AJCC 8th edition, and Dr. Shaha himself joined us from Memorial of Sloan Kettering. So we have a panel of great speakers joining us from all over the country, in fact, for the rest of the series as well. So these are the list of topics that will be covered over the period of the next few weeks, and then we'll follow it up with another module, hopefully on the thyroid gland. So we are supported by our association in Karnataka, the Academy of Head and Neck Oncology of Karnataka. So anybody from Karnataka who would like to join this association, please reach out to the email ID given below, or you can reach out to us and we'll be happy to connect. So today's talk is going to be moderated by Dr. Mithali Dandekar. She is a consultant head and neck surgeon who's been trained at Tata Memorial Hospital. She is also trained in microvascular surgery and in lateral skull-based surgery by Dr. Fish himself. And she has been involved in the landmark NEJM paper that, you know, Tata is famous for. And she's also, among other public international publications, she's also on the editorial board of many international journals on head and neck cancer. And she is one of the role models for, you know, all us female head and neck surgeons. Thank you for joining us today, ma'am. I hand over the session to you to, you know, introduce our speaker for today.
So a very good evening, everyone. And thanks, Shalini, for this kind introduction. It gives me immense pleasure to also introduce you all to Dr. Supreeta Arya. Well, she is a radiologist par excellence. She has been an integral part of the Tata Memorial Center in Mumbai, and in fact, has been an integral part of several joint clinic discussions to solve many head and neck oncology conundrums and helped us come to accurate management of patients of head and neck oncology. Well, apart from her immense experience as a radiologist, she has been involved in several landmark articles on head and neck cancer and imaging. And currently she is an independent educator and she's a member of several expert panels across the country as well as the United States. I would hand over the session to Dr. Supreeta Arya and look forward to this talk on guiding surgeons on operability in head and neck cancers through radiology.
Thank you, Mithali. That was a very kind introduction. And I must say that all that I have learned in head neck is because of the close interaction with you clinicians. And so today's talk is going to be the product of all that experience that I got by interacting with you all and working on the patients at Tata Memorial. So should I now begin the talk? Do I share the screen now?
Yes, ma'am, you can share the screen.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So do I go into the slide share mode? Yeah. Okay. So today's topic that was given to me was oral cavity cancer, the radiological pointers for operability, what a surgeon needs to know. So what I think is that a surgeon needs to know a lot more questions. First, what is the true disease extent? That is the TNM stage and information beyond TNM staging. What is the therapy plan that I'm going to adopt? Is it a single modality or multiple modality? And now this depends upon the stage of the disease. And is this disease resectable, both for the primary as well as for the novel disease? And there are more questions like which imaging modality do I order for each subsite of the oral cavity or for the oropharynx? Is it multi-detector CT or MRI? Is there any specific method for any region? Would I get more information from PET CT than CT or MR? Should I add ultrasonography for the neck if I've done CT or MR for the primary? So let's see, as the talk progresses, all these questions are going to be answered. So the subsides of the oral cavity are the following. Now, if you look at the central part, there is the tongue, and below that is the floor of the mouth. And central part, superiorly, is the hard palate. Now, these three subsides form what is called the oral cavity proper. Now, laterally, the vestibule consists of the upper and the lower alveolus with the gingiva, medially. And in the lateral part of the vestibule is the buccal mucosa. And far posteriorly, in this region, is the retromolar trigone, which is from the lower molar to the upper molar, this mucosal region. Now, can we see all this on CT? We can see this both on CT and MR, but here is an image that I'm showing you. It's called a CT with a puffed cheek technique. Now, here the patient has puffed his cheek and is breathing quietly and has also put a pocket of air between the heart palate and the tongue. And the imaging has been done, axial scans have been acquired, and this is a coronal reformation on a multi-detector CT. And so this is the oral cavity proper. That's the tongue, that's the floor of the mouth, that's the heart palate. And this is the upper alveolus, this is the lower alveolus. They are covered by gingiva, but on a normal contrast enhanced CT, you don't see the normal gingiva. So if you see soft tissue, it would be abnormal. This is the buccal mucosa. And on this coronal reformation, you don't see the retromolar trigone. So if I do an oblique sagittal reformation, I see the retromolar trigone, which is the shaded area from the lower mandibular molar to the upper mandibular molar. This is the mucosa. So that's what I see here on my CT oblique sagittal reformation. Now, what is the optimal modality that you would prefer for each subside? As a referring clinician, you should have some idea. So for the oral cavity proper, that means for the tongue, the floor of the mouth, and the heart palate, you can very easily ask for a contrast enhanced MRI. You would get all the information that you need. And for the lateral part of the tongue, which is, So why am I going to choose the contrast enhanced MR? Look at this image. This is a contrast enhanced CT. I have adjusted the contrast to the maximum, and this is the lesion that I'm seeing. The contrast between the lesion and the adjacent tongue is not as much as on a contrast enhanced MR, where it is maximum. The tumor tongue contrast is maximum. So that's why I would prefer a contrast enhanced MR when I'm imaging soft tissue structure like tongue and floor of mouth. So when it comes to the vestibular cancers, that means the ones where the bone is of importance, the status of the bone is of importance, I would prefer a multi-detector CT with puffed cheek technique. Of course, you can use a contrast enhanced MR as well, but in regions of the country where there is high volume and you want to do a satisfactory examination, a CT serves admirably because it has got speed of scanning and it gives you information on the bone status. So for the vestibular cancer, that means the gingival, the buccal, and the retromolar trigone, you can ask for a multi-detector CT. So is there any need for a second imaging method for the nodes? Let's assume you've used CT or MR for the primary. So this is the Liao meta-analysis published in 2012 in BMC. You can see the sensitivity and specificity of various modalities. You can see that the sensitivity is comparable across all, except a little less for CT. However, the highest specificity is for CT. And again, the specificities are somewhat comparable. But none of this will approximate that of elective neck dissection. So basically, by adding a second method to the primary method that you're using for imaging the primary site, you're not going to achieve much. So there is no need to add ultrasonography if you're already doing a CT or MR. And is there any role for PET? Again, if you want to look for the neck nodes, there is no need to add PET because it does not help in evaluating the clinically negative neck. There is a Kya's meta-analysis which has showed that there's only a 50% value in the N0 neck. So when do you add PET CT? You only add it for metastatic workup. that is in higher stage cancers, in 3 and 4, in order to look for the metastatic, distant metastasis. And if you are giving radiation, you can map the nodal burden in the neck with PET CT. So now let's come to the vestibular cancers, which are the gingival, the buccal, and the retromolar trigone cancers. What does the clinician want to know? The most important issue in this region is bone erosion, because in 14 to 75% of cases, in various papers, they report that there is bone erosion. So you need to know whether bone erosion is present or not, and what is the extent of bone erosion. And contrast enhanced multi-detector CT has very high sensitivity, 94 to 96%, and very high negative predictive value, high specificity. And the other information that you want to know at this site is the posterior soft tissue extent. How far posteriorly has the soft tissue extended? Because this is something that you will not know with your clinical examination. Then perineural spread is another entity that imaging will help you know. And nodal metastasis, although we know that imaging is no longer as good for nodal metastasis, anyway, if there is obvious nodal metastasis and contralateral nodal metastasis, imaging may give you information. So these are the issues, and now we are going to see how imaging is going to help us resolve these issues. So let's come first to the bone erosion. So this is a bone window on a soft tissue algorithm. So when we acquire CT scans, we do it on the soft tissue window. Now, if you change with a click of a button, you can change that soft tissue window into a bone window. But this is the kind of image that you get with a bone window. So when you're imaging oral cavity cancers, you must also acquire another algorithm called the bone algorithm. Reconstruction should be also done in something called bone algorithm, which is much sharper. So this is an oblique sagittal deformation. And here you can see that what is looking very, like indistinct in this image is seen very sharply in this image. You can see that the cortex is eroded. The mass is going right up to the inferior alveolar canal, which is seen in its entirety on this oblique sagittal deformation. So armed with all this, that is your bone algorithm, your puff cheek technique, and multi-planar reformations. That means you acquire CT scans axially, but you can reconstruct it on the workstations into an oblique sagittal and a coronal reformation. So you get three-dimensional information. So on this three-dimensional information, you can get a lot of information. Is erosion present or not? Which segment of the mandible is involved? Is it the lateral part of the mandible, lateral segment, or is it the mid-third segment? What is the length of the erosion? You can measure on this oblique sagittal. What is the depth of the erosion? You can see on the coronal reformation as well as on this reformation. And is the canal involved or not? So all this information you're going to get. And so film-based evaluation of the mandible is simply insufficient. You have to look at the mandible. The radiologist has to look at the mandible on multiplanar reformation done on his workstation and should give you the information. And that too on this algorithm. So with this, you can get information which can help you decide that am I going to do a marginal mandibulectomy where I just remove the alveolar crest, or am I going to do a segmental mandibulectomy? And how is the radiologist going to help you get this decision? So here are some images. In this image, you can see that there is a paramandibular soft tissue which is abutting the mandible. This is a soft tissue window. So now we change it to a bone algorithm window. So on the bone algorithm, you see that this soft tissue is causing erosion of the mandible near the tooth socket, and a little bit of cortex is eroded. However, 1.9 centimeters of the shaft of the dentate mandible is preserved. So if you need at least a 1 centimeter height of a dentate mandible to be preserved for marginal mandibulectomy to be feasible. So in this case, marginal mandibulectomy can be performed. On the other hand, look at this case. There is a large paramandibular soft tissue mass and it is contacting the entire shaft of the mandible. So for oncologically safe resection margins, you need to perform a segmental mandibulectomy. Now the second example is when the soft tissue causes extensive erosion of the mandible. In that case, obviously you have to do a segmental mandibulectomy. But even if erosion does not happen and it contacts the entire height of the mandible, the case will require a segmental mandibulectomy. So if you have a close rapport with your radiologist and you, all this information is available to you in the form of various deformations, you can take your decision whether it's going to be a marginal or segmental mandibulectomy. So so just to summarize, you look for erosion present or not. Second, you look for the paramandibular soft tissue. Even if the erosion is not there, you look for the paramandibular soft tissue component and how much height of the mandibular height is spared. And the for this, the mandible needs to be dentate. It's if a dentate mandible is spared of sufficient height of erosion, then you can perform a marginal mandibulectomy. On the other hand, if it's an edentulous mandible, then this does not hold. Such mandibles have to go for segmental mandibulectomy if the paramandibular soft tissue is contacting them or eroding them. Now, can you use MR for mandibular invasion? Although many centers use MRI for oral cavity, the problem with MRI is that it tends to overestimate cortical invasion and inferior alveolar nerve invasion. However, it's very good for marrow invasion. So now here is a case where there was a soft tissue which was abutting the entire height of the mandible and the inferior alveolar nerve inside was showing enhancement. We thought that this was involvement of the nerve. However, on segmental mandibulectomy done, it was found that the nerve was uninvolved. So MRI has a tendency to overestimate both cortical invasion as well as inferior alveolar nerve invasion. So this may result in unnecessary mandibulectomies. So that's why I prefer to do a CT scan for gingival, buccal and retromolar trigone cancers. Now the second point that the clinician wants to know after bone erosion is the posterior soft tissue extent. This is something that clinical examination simply cannot tell you and it's only imaging that will reveal. Now, let's look at the AJCC T4 staging. That's divided into T4A and T4B. T4A is when the bone is involved, mandible, maxillary sinus, and the facial skin. The extrinsic tongue muscles have now been removed. AJCC calls it moderately advanced. It does not mention whether operable or inoperable, but they're all operable. On the other hand, T4B is the masticator space involvement, pterygoid plate, skull base, and internal carotid artery involvement. It's called very advanced, and there's no mention about operable or not, but we know that select cases of T4B are operable. And these criteria have been devised by surgeons active in this field who encounter frequently cases of advanced oral cancer where some kind of relief has to be given to the patient. So even these very advanced cases, criteria have been laid down as to which one to operate and which one to leave alone. Now let's look at some examples. Now, both are T4B. Why is this a T4B? There is a soft tissue mass which is touching the masseter muscle. Masseter muscle is a content of the masticator space. So this is a T4B. On the other hand, this is also a T4B because it has completely destroyed the pterygoid plates. Obviously, you can see that this is a very early T4B, whereas this is very advanced T4B. So we do need criteria as to which one is operable and which one is not operable. So one of the earliest criteria when searching literature I found was Liao et al. From Taiwan, published in Oral Oncology 2007, that a subset of oral cancers with masticator space extension, that is T4B cases, a subset which extended below the level of this mandibular sigmoid notch did well. And they did as well as the T4A cases. Whereas the cases which went above this notch, they had about 8 cases, whereas the rest 40 or something were T4B, low T4B. Now these cases did badly. So this was the criteria that operate the cases which is below the sigmoid notch. Now how can the radiologist give you this information? Now, are not familiar with masticator space. And the radiologist is familiar with the masticator space and not very clear about the intratemporal fossa. Now, what is the masticator space? It is a fascia lines compartment, which begins, the floor is at the lower border of the mandible, and it contains the central strut of the mandible and the masticator muscles. This is the masseter on the outer surface. This is the medial pterygoid coming from the medial surface of lateral pterygoid plate to the inner angle of the masseter. and this is the lateral pterygoid coming from the lateral surface of the pterygoid plate and inserting into the condyle of the mandible. And in the roof of this masticator space is the foramen ovale. So this is your masticator space. What is the infratemporal fossa? These red enclosed space is the infratemporal fossa. This is not a fascia lined space. This is simply a space which is inside the vertical ramus of the mandible going all the way up to the lateral wall of the nasopharynx. And again in the roof, the foramen ovale lies there and the floor is incomplete. There is no proper floor like here because it's not fascia lined. So the only difference between the masticator space and the infratemporal fossa is the lateromedial boundaries. So the masseter is not there in the infratemporal fossa. So honestly, when we both are speaking about masticator space and intratemporal fossa, we are speaking about the same, essentially the same space. So we are not so interested now whether it's the masseter or masticator space or the intratemporal space, fossa. What we are more interested is, where has the disease gone? Is it in the lower part of either of these spaces or is it in the upper part of the space? Because this yellow line shows you the level of the sigmoid notch. As I told you, disease going above this level is better not operated. So this is the low masticator space, or rather this is the low infratemporal fossa, and this is the high masticator space, and this is the high intratemporal fossa. Now, how do you differentiate between the low and the high? The lateral pterygoid muscle is located in the high intratemporal fossa or masticator space, whereas the medial pterygoid is located in the lower space. So if you take an axial section, this is the level of the sigmoid notch. The patient is slightly tilted. So here the notch, this is one level slightly above the notch. Now, this is the insertion of the temporalis muscle and that's the lateral pterygoid. That's the masseter. So if the radiologist on axial section sees that the tumor has gone above this notch, it is coming above the notch and is involving the lateral pterygoid, that is high masticator space disease. And this feature you can see can be revealed only by imaging. Now, there have been surgeons who have been even more enterprising and have done compartment dissections in the intratemporal fossa. And they have decided that even in the high masticator space, that if it is involving the anterior part of the space, that means the retroantral, this is the antrum, maxillary antrum. This is the retroantral fat. And so if the disease reaches the high masticator space, but reaches anteriorly in this region of the fat, it is operable. On the other hand, if the lateral pterygoid muscle is involved, it is certainly a contraindication for surgery. So regarding posterior soft tissue extent, this is the operability criteria, that preferably operate below the sigmoid notch, and if it is above the sigmoid notch, select surgeons may operate the ones reaching the anterior compartment, that is, which is reaching the retroantral fat. So this is an example of a low masticator space lesion. Here is a mass coming from the oral cavity and invading the medial pterygoid muscle and eroding the mandible. On the other hand, this is a coronal reformation showing a mass reaching right up to the base skull. This is a high masticator space lesion. Now let's come to the third point. After bone erosion and after posterior soft tissue extent, I mentioned perineural spread. So this is the masticator space, which we discussed earlier. That's the medial pterygoid muscle. That's the masseter on the outer surface of the mandible. That's the lateral pterygoid muscle. Between the lateral pterygoid and the medial pterygoid, from the mandibular foramen, the V3 nerve goes to the foramen ovale. So when you see perineural spread from the oral cavity, it can come through the inferior alveolar nerve, exit through the mandibular foramen and go up through this V3 nerve to the through the foramen ovale into the Meckel's cave and to the cavernous sinus. So here is an example of perineural spread. Advanced cases of perineural spread can be seen on CT. Early cases are seen on MRI. Now here you can see that on this image, you can see that there's some nice fat plane between the, this is the temporalis muscle coming from here, and that's the medial pterygoid. There's a good fat plane here. On the other hand, there is some extra soft tissue in this region, and on reformation, it was not so well visible on the axial, but on reformation, you can find a thick cord-like structure going from the mandibular foramen right up to the foramen ovale, shown by these yellow arrows. So this is perineural spread along V3. So as I said, the advanced cases are seen on CT, but the early cases are best seen on MRI, contrast enhanced, and coronal images, fat suppressed. So here is the V3 nerve showing intense enhancement compared to the other side, thickened and enhancing. And on the axial images, you find that there is excessive enhancement around the mandibular foramen. So these are features of perineural spread. So this is a contraindication for surgery, and this is a feature that can be seen on imaging. And the accuracy of this criterion on imaging is about 70%. So now let's come to the tongue and the floor of the mouth. Now the tongue is a structure with lots of muscles wrapped up in a mucous membrane. So it needs a modality with superior soft tissue characterization. And that modality is contrast enhanced MRI. Now, as I told you, MRI may be a little bit overestimating the mandibular erosion. However, fortunately for us, in tongue and floor of mouth cancers, the incidence of bone erosion is far less what you see in gingival and buccal cancers. So before we come to the criteria for resectability in tongue cancers, let's discuss this concept, this interesting concept of depth of invasion. The AJCC 8th edition is now categorized T1, T2, and T3, not only on the basis of maximum dimensions, like 2 centimeters, 2 to 4, or greater than 4, but also on something called depth of invasion, T1 being less than or equal to 5 mm, T2 being more than 5 mm and less than equal to 10 mm, and more than 10 mm being T3. Now what happens is that when tumors are T1, T2, N0, they are stage 1 tumors, they would go for a single modality treatment. When the tumors are T3 and above, then they would be a higher stage and they would go for multimodality treatment. So what is depth of invasion? Essentially, it's a concept which is measured on histopathology. Now let's see this example. In this case, this entire dark structure is the tumor. It is exophytic and is extending right up to here. Now, this horizontal blue line is the basement membrane. The concept of depth of invasion is with reference to the basement membrane. So you see this blue line dropped from the basement membrane to the deepest part of the tumor. This is the depth of invasion. On the other hand, the entire thickness of the tumor, right from the exophytic component to the depth of the tumor, is the tumor thickness. This is an exophytic lesion and this is an ulcerative lesion. In an ulcerative lesion, the concept of depth of invasion is a little different. So here is an ulcerated sloughed off tumor. So if you want the true depth of invasion, you have to measure the distance from the adjacent basement membrane. So you extrapolate the basement membrane to the region where the tumor is sloughed off, and from there to the deepest portion is the depth of invasion. On the other hand, if you just measure the thickness, that would be the tumor thickness, and that would be less. So depth of invasion, the reference line is the basement membrane. So how do we then measure such a concept, depth of invasion on imaging? AJCC has included this in the clinical TNM, which means imaging has to give you some information on depth of invasion. Now, what the clinician when examining is able to see is the longitudinal extent, the greatest dimension, and maybe the supero-inferior extent of the tumor. However, for a tumor which is located along the lateral border of the tongue, the lateromedial extent is the tumor thickness or depth of invasion. This is something which could be submucosal and may not be discernible to the clinician. And this dimension is what imaging will give you information on. So when it comes to depth of invasion, remember that 85% of the tumors are along the lateral border of the tongue. And there the depth of invasion would be a lateromedial dimension. On the other hand, if there is a tumor on the ventral surface of the tongue, that means the undersurface of the tongue, the dimension which is perpendicular to that would be the depth of invasion, which means it would be a inferosuperior dimension. So let's consider the case of 85% of tumors which occur along the lateral border. So you want to know the depth of invasion. Now, on imaging, it is extremely difficult to get an approximation of the basement membrane. So if you measure it on imaging, obviously in an ulcerative lesion, it is going to fall short of this measurement. And in an exophytic lesion, you will end up measuring the exophytic component also. So what you measure on imaging, the depth of invasion, can never be, it would actually be the thickness, and it can never be the histopathological. However, the amount of exophytic extrusion or the amount of ulceration, it would be only a difference in a few, points of a millimeter. So by imaging, you would get an approximate idea of the, whatever, the tumor thickness or the depth of invasion. And there have been authors who have specified, methods to measure this tumor thickness. If you read my article in IJRI, your radiologist can go through this method mentioned by Lam et al. So that's how you can get the depth of invasion on imaging. Although there is a limitation. There's this, in context with the depth of invasion, I came across a very interesting paper, the magnetic resonance imaging findings of styroglossus and hyoglossus muscle invasion, relationship of these muscles invasion to the depth of invasion as a predictor for advisability of elective neck dissection. Now, as you know, AJCC has knocked out extrinsic tug muscles from the T4A staging. So in that context, here is an image. These are the genioglossus muscles. This is where it originates, and here it goes and inserts into the intrinsic muscles. Now, this is the hyoglossus muscle. It originates from near the hyoid, and then it goes up, and it then inserts into the intrinsic muscles. So at the point where the hyoglossus muscle inserts into the intrinsic muscles, so these authors are saying that if you measure the distance of the tumor from the lateral border of the tongue up to the hyoglossus, this is approximately about 4 millimeters. So 4 millimeters or little less than 4 millimeters. So if the tumor reaches this hyoglossus, it has to be about 4 millimeters. And if you look at previous literature, the depth of invasion of 4 millimeters and above was a very significant predictor of neck node metastasis. So although the AJCC has removed extrinsic tongue muscles, the value of this may be to see the distance of the tumor to the hyoglossus. And if the hyoglossus is involved, then probably there is a high chance of neck node metastasis, and you could take a call on neck node dissection, elective neck node dissection. Now let's see some examples of tongue cancers. Now this is a tongue cancer along the lateral border. It has not reached up to the midline. On the other hand, this has reached up to the midline. Here you can do a partial grossectomy. This has reached up to the midline. This has crossed the midline. So when it crosses the midline, there is a high probability of contralateral nodal metastasis, and there may be a need. There is definitely a need to address the opposite neck. So this is one information that you can get from imaging, because the spread across to the contralateral side is often submucosal and may not be visible on clinical examination. Now, another predictor of operability and the extent of operability is the involvement of the neurovascular bundle. Now, in the first image, this is the tumor. It's involved the neurovascular bundle on the same side. This is the lingual artery. And that's the vein. And it's involved one side neurovascular bundle. On the other hand, in the second image, it has crossed the midline and it has involved both the neurovascular bundles. In fact, it's reaching down up to the mylohyoid. So here you would require a total grossectomy, and the fact that it's reached right up to the mylohyoid, you will require a significant reconstruction. So this is another information that you get from imaging, the amount of excision and the amount of reconstruction as well. Then if the tumor, which is in the anterior tongue, extends all the way back to the valacula and the pre-epiglottic space, this is a relative surgical contraindication because the surgery becomes too morbid. Again, if the tumor goes all the way up to the level of the tonsil, this also becomes morbid surgery. So here you may take it as a relative surgical contraindication and may perform chemoradiation instead. Now, involvement of the mandible. Now, here is a tumor which abuts the mandible. For oncologically safe resection margins, you may still perform a mandibulectomy. Here is something which invades the cortex of the mandible and the marrow. So what information you get from imaging is which segment of the mandible is involved. Is it the mid third of the mandible or the lateral third? Because accordingly, you have to plan your surgery. And so if I have to summarize, tumors which spread across the midline, you have to plan therapy for bilateral nodal metastasis, for bilateral surgical neck dissection. And for inferior spread, you look at one neurovascular bundle or both. If both are involved, then total glossectomy. If there is far posterior spread into tonsil, valicular, pre-epiglottic space, or if it is touching the hyoid, it may be a relative surgical contraindication. When it goes very far posterior into the masticator space, which is extremely rare, then it's very advanced and it would go for palliative radiation, chemoradiation. And when it comes to lateral spread, bone erosion, you look for which part of the bone is involved, the mid third or the lateral segment. And if it's perineural spread, then it's adverse prognosis. It may be a surgical contraindication. So this is all the information that you get from imaging to decide about your surgical decisions. So to summarize, I told you about the various imaging methods for imaging oral cancers. For the central part, we use preferably MRI. For the lateral part, you can do with CT. And you don't need to add a second imaging method for the neck. And PET CT is only to be used for advanced cancers when you're looking for metastasis. I told you about the resectability criteria for like gingivobuccal and RMT cancers, that is bone erosion, posterior soft tissue extent, and perineural spread, and how imaging gives you information that, on that. I mentioned about the imaging features of tongue cancers and their spread and how it influences surgical decisions. And we also discussed the concept of depth of invasion and the relationship of the hyoglossus muscle invasion to the concept of depth of invasion. Thank you.
So thank you, Dr. Arya, for a wonderful presentation. I think it made everything was so clear after through your talk. We have a few questions by the audience. Would you like to elaborate on the role of diffusion-weighted imaging in head and neck cancers per se?
The role of diffusion-weighted imaging. See, the diffusion-weighted imaging is not useful for differentiating between benign and metastatic nodes. My student had a thesis on tongue cancers where we studied the diffusion-weighted imaging on small nodes, sub-centimeter nodes, and we found that both reactive and malignant nodes showed overlapping ADC values. So diffusion weighted doesn't have a role in the primary setting, but diffusion weighted imaging definitely has a role in post-treatment cases where you're monitoring response to induction chemotherapy. So here, in case of PET CT, you have to wait up to 10 to 12 weeks to find the response. But in those cases where you're giving induction chemotherapy, I feel diffusion weighted has a fertile role tomorrow, a potential role to assess early response to such therapy.
So for the benefit of the audience, could you just give us a brief this of what you
what
mean?
What is diffusion?
Yeah.
So diffusion weighted imaging, it studies the cellularity of the tissues. Malignant tissues are highly cellular and they show something called restricted diffusion. So whenever you're studying diffusion-weighted imaging, there are two sets of images. There is a B-value image and there is an ADC map. So when a tumor shows like bright signal on the B-value image and a dark signal on the ADC map, that is called qualitative restricted diffusion. On the other hand, if it's the reverse, if it's dark on the B-value image and bright on the ADC map, it's called facilitated diffusion. That means this is like water intensity. On the other hand, if it's malignant tissues, they will have restricted diffusion. They will be dark on the ADC map. And this is qualitative diffusion. Apart from that, on the ADC map, you can do some measurements. That's called quantitative diffusion weighted imaging. You can do measurements and there are certain values. Malignancies typically will show low ADC values, and benign conditions will show high ADC values. And so you can monitor the ADC values in the post-treatment, and based on whether the ADC values are rising or falling, you can gauge whether it is responding to treatment or not.
There's another question as to a lot of our patients come with tumor-related edema, majority of them along the zygoma or posteriorly in the tongue cancers along the varicula. Is there a way in which you can differentiate tumor edema from tumor proper? And the same goes for, let's just club it all together, the same goes for recurrent cases who have been treated extensively. Is there a way to determine post-RT edema vis-a-vis actual cancers?
So, I don't know whether there have been studies that reporting this, but I would assume that post-RT edema will look, there will be stranding in the subcutaneous fat, and tumor should show, tumoral infiltration should show enhancement, nodule-like enhancement in that region. So, this would be a florid case. If there is nodule-like enhancement, that would be probably tumor. Whereas if it is simply stranding, then it would be inflammatory. But I think this is a slight limitation of imaging, because there was a study where 13 cases were studied with stranding in the subcutaneous fat. They wanted to know whether the skin was involved or not. And they found that in 12 of the 13 cases, the stranding was inflammatory and it was not tumor. So till today, imaging is not the way that you find skin infiltration. You assess skin infiltration by clinical, by the pod, the orange appearance, okay? So similarly, I think there may be a limitation of imaging to differentiate between that post-RT edema and between tumor recurrence, unless there are well-defined nodules which are enhancing in that region.
Okay. We probably could take some questions pertaining to the neck in oral cancers. You have a study based on the involvement of the carotid artery vis-a-vis resectability, I think with paragangliomas, if I'm not mistaken,
yeah,
with Dr.
Yeah.
Vishal Rao.
Yeah.
Could you extrapolate the same for neck involvement in oral cancers as well?
So actually, this study was already been done by USIM et al. For squamous carcinoma metastatic nodes. And we extrapolated this study to apply it to carotid body tumors. Basically, what it does was, I forgot to show that in my slide, that you look, when it comes to deciding the resectability of neck nodes in oral cancers, you study the circumferential contact of that node with the internal carotid artery or the common carotid artery. Now, if you find more than, like, if it is 3/4 or more of the circumference of the vessel being in contact with the node, then probably the node is unresectable. Like, when you try to resect the node, you may have to resect the carotid, so which is never done. So basically, this is an unresectable case. On the other hand, if the tumor and arterial contact is less than half the circumference, which means less than 180 degrees, the tumor, the node will be easily resected from the vessel. So what you look at is the circumferential contact between the artery and the node, whether it's up to 180 degree or if it is more than 270 degrees. Now, what happens if it is between 180 and 270? As you go closer towards 270, that means you cross 240 onwards, it becomes increasingly difficult to resect the node from the vessel. So I would say that up to an angle of contact of 240 degrees, probably you'll be able to peel the vessel off the node. But beyond that, it would be risky.
Okay. There's another question. Is there any role of ultrasound currently for a neck nodal assessment?
So that, as I said, that the neck nodal assessment, as the Liao meta-analysis showed, that there was no advantage where the sensitivity and specificity of ultrasound was concerned as compared to the other modalities. And the trial done at Tata also, where the ultrasound was used, also showed that there was, in a large setting, with the when there are sub-centimeter nodes, I do not think ultrasound has any advantage. The advantage of ultrasound is when there are already palpable nodes, it helps in ultrasound-guided effinacy of large nodes. But when it comes to sub-centimeter nodes, there's enough literature which says that the accuracy and the yield of ultrasound goes falls as the size of the nodes also falls. Because what happens is that the metastatic focus in sub-centimeter nodes is not distributed throughout the nodes. It is localized to one pole of the node. For the radiologist to identify exactly that pole and to take a representative sample may not always be feasible, which is why I think there's a limited role of ultrasound for the ipsilateral neck. The role of ultrasound could be for the contralateral neck. Maybe like in the ipsilateral neck, you've already taken a decision to operate the neck based on the characteristics of the primary.
I think the participant would like to know the characteristics of determining involvement of a node rather than the clinical aspect.
The abnormal features of nodes are, a typical node should be, a benign node should be ovoid, and it will have a bright hilum, which is eccentric. And it is kind of flattish. Sometimes the reactive nodes in Indian population, they'll be a little large. But the fact that that oval node, flattened node, is a sign of a benign or a reactive node. On the other hand, a malignant node tends to be rounded, and it tends to show one of the most important features of a metastatic node is the presence of necrosis, that is pathognomonic. Although in our population, a small subset of tuberculosis nodes may complicate it, but usually if you see necrosis, then it is a metastatic node. Secondly, if you find, as I said, rounded shape with homogeneous enhancement and irregular borders. And on MRI, if you find heterogeneity of the node and if you find irregular borders, these are also features of abnormal nodes. Then in the region of the draining primary, if you find a cluster of nodes, this clustering is also a feature of probably metastatic nodes. So it's very important to see whether the abnormal node is in the region of the draining primary. Like if there is a right lateral tongue lesion and there looks to be an abnormal node in the left level 4, in the opposite side level 4, it will seldom be a metastatic node. It could be something else. It could be a tuberculous node, or it could be a node from another primary in the abdomen. So you have to study the entire picture. Like you have to see the draining region with more suspicion and other nodes with less suspicion, other regions with less suspicion. And that's how a radiologist should give you the report. For the draining region, there should be a specific report for the nodes. And for the other regions, the nodes have to be again reported in a separate group.
So now let's move on to the assessment of pterygomaxillary fissure and bone marrow in the mandible. Is there a way, would you prefer a CT or an MRI?
For studying the pterygomaxillary fissure. Now see, there is a bit of a confusion in everybody's mind about the pterygomaxillary fissure and the pterygopalatine fossa. Okay, the pterygomaxillary fissure is the junction between the pterygoid plate and that infratemporal fossa. I wish I had an image to show you. But the pterygopalatine fossa is right at the base skull region, which is just behind the base of the pterygoid plates. An involvement of the pterygopalatine fossa becomes a surgical contraindication, whereas pterygomaxillary fissure involvement is just a part of low masticator space invasion. So that is not a big deal. It is the pterygopalatine fossa which is the surgical contraindicator. And both the surgeons and the radiologists should know the difference between these two. And if you want to look at the bone, the best thing, to see the pterygoid plates, which are next to the pterygomaxillary fissure, the CT is better. But in the pterygopalatine fossa, there lies the V2 nerve. And if you want to see perineural invasion in that, MRI is preferable. So, and a good radiologist is able to discern the bony status on the, I think the cardinal importance here is the perineural spread. And that information is given better by MRI. When it comes to pterygomaxillary fissure, I mean, this information is available both on CT and MR. But if it is about pterygopalatine fossa and invasion of the adjacent nerve, then MR is the preferred modality.
So typically in a buccal gingival buccal complex cancer, we would prefer a MDCT. So when the patient, when the lesion is reaching in the high ITF, like you said, the supra-notch area, and you're suspecting that, like the patient probably presents with complete trismus, are you making a suggestion that we should order a contrast enhanced MRI in such a situation to see these areas like the pterygopalatine fossa, or a CT would be good enough to give us that information?
I feel a CT would be good enough because of this reason. Like when it reaches the high masticator space itself, it is a surgical contraindication. So then why would you want to look at the pterygopalatine fossa if you already taken a decision not to operate because the lateral pterygoid muscle has been invaded? Okay, and even on CT, the pterygopalatine fossa may, if you find extra soft tissue as compared to the opposite side, it suggests pterygopalatine fossa invasion. So CT, actually, when it comes to the masticator space, there's enough fat planes around the muscles, and that's why I feel that a CT suffices. You don't have to really order for a contrast enhanced MR. On the other hand, in the tongue, there's so much of soft tissue that without any intervening fat planes, that is where you have to use a contrast enhanced MR. But
so, sorry, go ahead.
So in gingivobuccal cancers, which is spreading posteriorly, according to my experience, a CT suffices.
So that's what a very pertinent point made by madam, that it one should refrain as a clinician from ordering too many imaging modalities from the same patient. So like she said, a CT scan is good enough to tell us the nodal status. A CT scan, which you would probably order in a gingival buccal complex cancer, would give us a good enough information on the high ITF status. And hence, ordering a CT plus an MRI would obviously be unnecessary to a large extent. So clinical judgment along with a single modality imaging modality would be good enough to come to a final diagnosis or a final management protocol. Is that am I right when I say that?
Yeah, Mithali, one thing I wanted to add is that whenever a clinician is referring for MR, you know, you have to know the experience level of your radiologist. There are some centers which are doing, like I know that my friend like Diva and Dr. Tuprani, they do a lot of MR for oral cancers and they have reached a high level of experience and they prefer MRs. But in centers which haven't done MR regularly, if you are going to order an MR, the radiologist may not even be familiar with those MR appearances and it may be a waste of an examination. On the other hand, a CT done well, especially you have 64 slice scanners nowadays, and if you use that information, you're seeing, looking at the multiplanar information, etc., both the radiologists and surgeons can be comfortable on that CT imaging.
Right. So one of the participants would like you to kind of demonstrate, if possible, the difference between pterygomaxillary fissure and the fossa, if you have any slides on that in your presentation.
In my presentation, I'll have to go now and look for slides.
Okay.
But I could do that if you are answering some questions in the meanwhile. I could look for this.
So maybe you could give us a little hint as to how far above the actual maxillary sinus do we look for, or things like that.
So I will have to share my presentation. 1 minute. Is my slide visible right now? I mean, my presentation?
No.
Okay. 1 minute.
Meanwhile, ma'am, Dr. Mithali.
Yeah,
ma'am.
I've got an image, but I'll have to share screen for that.
Yeah.
Please. Shall I?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Is Is it visible, the image now?
Yes.
Is this visible?
Yes.
Can you see this?
Yes. Yes.
So this is the pterygopalatine fossa. Like, I can show you this 1 minute. Yeah. So here, this is the pterygoid plates, and that's the maxillary antrum. This is the pterygomaxillary fissure. This is the pterygomaxillary fissure. Is it visible, Mithali?
Yes.
Okay. So this is the pterygomaxillary fissure. You find that the pterygoid plates are closely opposed to the maxillary antrum in the lower sections. As you go higher, you will find that they tend to separate, as I showed you in a previous bit. As you go higher up, you find that a gap comes between the... Okay. As you go higher up near the skull base, there's a gap between the pterygoid plate base and the uppermost part of the sinuses. This is the pterygopalatine fossa. This one. Whereas the pterygomaxillary fissure was an angle, which I showed you. Where is it? So that gap was the pterygopalatine fossa, and this is the pterygomaxillary fissure.
So in short, the area of interest for us clinicians would be the pterygomaxillary, the pterygopalatine fossa to determine whether it's resectable or not. I hope it's clear now. Yeah.
So basically, the pterygomaxillary fissure is in the low masticator space, whereas the pterygopalatine fossa is in the high ITF or high masticator space.
Correct. Are there any other questions? Would you want to comment on PET CT scan, ma'am, or PET CT scan?
For what?
Yeah, so in a recurrent setting, post-treatment setting.
Oh, in a recurrent setting, yes. So in
a post-treatment surveillance imaging, yes. Would you think a good contrast-enhanced CT scan is as good as a PET CT to tell us whether the disease is under control or not?
See, I wouldn't say that. See, PET CT nowadays, what they do is contrast PET, okay? So you get both anatomic information and functional information. Whereas with a good contrast CT, you can never get that functional information. So ideally, if you can afford, you would want to do a PET CT post 10 weeks, 10 to 12 weeks. Okay. But if you cannot afford a PET CT, and if you have to make do with a contrast CT, then, like, for example, if you're talking about the oral cavity, then, a contrast-enhanced MR is preferable, especially when you're doing flap reconstructions and there's a lot of soft tissue and you want to pick up an abnormal nodule in that, then I don't think a CT will suffice. Then you would preferably do a contrast-enhanced MR. So the contrast-enhanced CT will help you in the places where you're suspecting bony involvement,
right,
or when you're suspecting osteoradionecrosis.
So
your clinical dilemma will decide whether you're going to send it for contrast-enhanced CT or a contrast-enhanced MR.
Correct.
And when it comes to larynx, a contrast-enhanced CT has got very good scoring system, which can tell you whether it is post-treatment changes or recurrence or equivocal and what to do according to that.
So,
and now there is a concept called NIRADS. The NIRADS is a post-treatment surveillance and it involves PET CT. However, there are NIRADS criteria coming up with contrast-enhanced CT as well as contrast-enhanced MR. But they found that this NIRADS is less accurate when you just keep it to CT or MR as compared to PET CT. So if you can afford, you do a PET CT. But if you do not, if you can't afford, there are ways to study the same thing. A good radiologist can give you a lot of information.
Correct.
Contrast-enhanced CT or MR.
So if one plans to do a post-treatment surveillance with a cross-sectional anatomical imaging, so the best time after for post-treatment surveillance would be 12 weeks just as a PET CT?
No, you can do it earlier.
You can do it earlier, okay.
You can do it earlier.
Typically, what is the time frame that you suggest?
Typically, when would the patient come to you for follow-up?
6 weeks?
Yeah, 6 weeks is a good time to do it.
Okay.
And with diffusion-weighted MRI, it is good. It can pick up things earlier. That's the advantage. If they can, like, use diffusion weighted on a regular basis, the advantage of it is it can be done earlier than PET CT.
And so, is there any ADC cutoff for this?
No, the ADC, that is a catch. The fact is, for each case, there has to be a contrast enhanced study done before preferably on the same scanner with an ADC measured. And then you have to measure the ADC again in the post-treatment setting and compare with that ADC. So that is, there is no absolute cutoff. ADC values are relative.
Relative. Okay. Which modality of imaging could pick up skin metastasis in advanced oral cavity cancers?
Skin metastasis, like if there's an obvious like nodule, it will be even palpable clinically. CT or MRs are not good for the skin. I mean, the subtle skin involvement, CT MR, that's the limitation.
So there was one question as to what modality would one prefer to detect bone marrow invasion in the mandible. I guess it would be
MRI.
Yeah, but ma'am, so if you look at it from a clinical standpoint, again, like we discussed previously, we would typically order a contrast enhanced CT scan for such patients because it is gingiva buccal complex cancers. But we would err towards doing an MR when there is gross bony involvement in terms of a pathological fracture of the mandible, and we really want to know whether the marrow is involved beyond the actual extent, actual extent of bone involvement. Am I right?
Yeah. See, you're right about this. When you're ordering a CT, marrow involvement in gingival buccal cancers happens only after the cortex is eroded. So if the cortex is intact, you do not have to worry about marrow invasion. If the cortex is intact, then you don't need to add an MR. You will add an MR when the cortex is eroded, marrow is involved, and you want to know an additional status, as like in the scenario you were mentioning just now.
Right.
Otherwise, in 90-95% of cases, like, you would not require to add an MR if you're just doing a good multi-detector CT. Because everywhere you get 64 slice scanners nowadays, and that suffices if it's done properly and if the field of view is chosen properly. It's if you do the study properly and if you use the multiplanar informations on the workstation, I think a lot of information can be got from a CT.
I think we by and large covered everything pertaining to imaging in oral cancers. Can you explain SUV? I think let's limit
these. That's a standard uptake, yeah.
Yeah, really. Let's limit the discussion to, let's leave PET CT away from a discussion now, since we do not have a nuclear medicine specialist with us. I think one last question, if I could ask. Any method in which you could tell us whether a patient who has a discharging sinus for a long time post-treatment, any way we can differentiate it, an early ORN vis-a-vis a recurrence?
When a patient has a discharging sinus, it's like a simple CT scan is very easily can pick up, difference between a tumor recurrence and osteoradionecrosis. In osteoradionecrosis, see, typically it would be about 1.5 years post-radiation, and you will find that there will be lytic destructive lesions and they will be diffuse and there will be no focal soft tissue, enhancing soft tissue associated with this destruction. There'll be a diffuse inflammation which is localized to the radiation portrait. However, tumor recurrence will be an enhancing focal mass which is eating up that bone focally. So it is easily possible to differentiate between an osteoradionecrosis and tumor recurrence. On the basis of a good CT.
Okay.
MR won't help here. It is CT is required.
Okay. Do we still have time or I think because we've already crossed 7.
Ma'am, if there are more questions, we can take them. Or if we've completed all the questions, I think we can call it.
I guess we have completed the entire set of questions pertaining to the oral oncology, the oral imaging. Are there any other questions? I don't see any other questions on the chat box.
No, ma'am, there aren't.
Okay. So I guess with this, thank you so much, Dr. Sukrita Arya. Really, it was great to have this discussion with you. Thank you so much. And thanks, Shalini and the team to have us today on this webinar.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, ma'am. Yeah. And
thank you, Shalini. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. I must say that, you covered everything that we usually ask our residents and fellows during rounds. And I think we keep quoting your paper all the time whenever we have to refer to any imaging regarding oral cancers. So thank you so much for today's talk. Thank you, Dr. Mitali, ma'am, for moderating the session so well. I would also like to thank my senior colleagues, Dr. Ravi Nair, Dr. Vishal Rao, and Dr. Akshay Kulpati, without whom we couldn't have done this. And the team behind this, Dr. Anand Subhash, who's been handling the social media handles, Dr. Bhargav, who's been coordinating the entire session in the background, and Dr. Ritvi Bagadia for helping out with the oral module. Thank you. And thank you, everybody, for joining in. It was a very pleasant evening. Thank you, ma'am.
And thank you, Shalini and Mitali. Excellent moderation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Take care.
Thank you.
Bye.
See you, ma'am. Thank you. Bye.